Hey everyone, it's Dr. Romani. Welcome back to this YouTube channel that takes on a whole host of issues related to narcissism and narcissistic relationships and just difficult personalities in general. Usually that's what I talk about entirely, but this month we're taking a little bit of a different twist. In the month of May, in sort of to notice Mental Health Awareness Month, I'm going to kind of give a review of a whole set of mental health issues that are commonly and not commonly diagnosed. Give you, again, a brief overview, nothing comprehensive, and then link these patterns to both narcissism and narcissistic abuse so you can see how those patterns of that personality pattern and what that personality pattern does to other people, how that kind of overlaps with many other mental health issues. Today we're going to talk about hoarding disorder. Some of you may have learned what you've learned about hoarding disorder by watching shows like Hoarders or having even seen it in your own life. Let's talk a little bit about this. Now, hoarding disorder is actually a newer diagnosis, even though the pattern's been around for a long time. It's a new diagnosis in the DSM-5, our diagnostic manual, and it occurs in somewhere between 2 and 6% of the population, one of these rare mental disorders that's more common in men than women. And again, unlike many other mental disorders, it's more common in older adults. So you see it actually in much older adults. That may very well be due to this idea that hoarding disorder is actually sometimes associated with things like loss. So it could be someone who's widowed or going through other life transitions. And some people have characterized hoarding disorder as almost like an emotional decision-making deficit. They're almost like this cross-circuit of not understanding that this sort of old worthless set of bills is worth nothing, or because things get so disorganized that you buy a can opener 5 times because you can't find the one you've already got. Interestingly, about 75% of people who have hoarding disorder also have a co-occurring other mental health condition. Around 20% of people with hoarding disorder also have obsessive compulsive disorder. So again, lots of overlaps there, and it is quite related to obsessive compulsive disorder. Hoarding symptoms can happen at any point in the lifetime, but we do tend to see some of it happening early in life and continuing throughout the lifespan, getting worse with each year if left untreated, which might be why it may be a person is a hoarder when they're younger, but it's not as manifest. But as the years go by and it's left unchecked, it accumulates over time to the point that when the person's older is when it finally gets noticed. A person with hoarding disorder will accumulate and collect items that aren't very useful, don't have much worth. They're sometimes broken, they're out of style, they're ripped, they're just not useful. And will accumulate those items many times in a way that sort of overtakes their environment and might even be causing a hazard, filling up hallways, things filling up rooms that shouldn't be used for that, taking over kitchens and bathrooms to the point where the home becomes either dangerous or uninhabitable. And there's also a strong unwillingness on the part of a person who has hoarding disorder to get rid of the items. And if a person tries to make them give them up, you'll often get a very angry, almost agitated reaction. Now, when we look at how hoarding disorder is diagnosed, what we see is a person who has a lot of difficulty throwing away or giving away possessions, regardless of the value they have. It's not like you're trying to say to someone, give me your grandmother's wedding ring. I mean, sometimes this is just bags and bags of old clothes. The difficulty the person has in getting rid of these items is due to the person with hoarding disorder's perception that they have to save this item. And there's too much distress associated with getting rid of them. There's a lot of like, what if I need this? Don't take this away. I won't be able to find this again. They haven't made this since the 1970s. There'll be like a lot of rationalizing. The difficulty in getting rid of the possessions results again in this sort of overcrowding of a house. The smaller the space somebody lives in, the more obvious that this is going to become. When people have very, very big houses, it might take a while before the stuff overtakes the space. In addition, people also may take up other spaces, like fill up a garage so it can't be used for cars or other useful items. They may get sheds they put in their backyard, or they may waste a lot of money on storage units, saving and holding on to all of this hoarded stuff. Sometimes we'll see people with hoarding disorder will have spaces that are uncluttered, but that likely only happened because third parties got involved, like family members came by and cleaned it up, or a housekeeper, or even the authorities, like public health authorities, will come to a yard and clean it out. And obviously all this needs to culminate in some kind of social or occupational impairment. Any of you who've ever witnessed hoarding, you know what it looks like. It's unmistakable. And you'll see that there's stuff everywhere. Open a closet and it's just full of stuff. You're saying, oh my goodness, we don't need these things. And yet the person really emotionally finds it challenging to give them up. Now, if we were to look at narcissistic abuse and hoarding disorder, it's interesting because, as I said, the research on hoarding disorder points to a breakdown in decision making. A person gets, again, stuck in this sort of emotional loop around discarding items and then feeling very indecisive and then getting almost really wedded to those items. It's like a pattern we see in obsessive compulsive spectrum disorders across the board, a lot of indecisiveness. Well, we also know that struggles with decision making are a part of narcissistic abuse. So perhaps in some cases, why it certainly wouldn't get to the level of a hoarding disorder, a person living with narcissistic abuse may also be struggling with decision making and may also struggle with throwing things away or making the decision of, do I need to get rid of this? Should I keep this? And having, again, trouble with that or doubt themselves. Though, again, is it going to escalate to the level of hoarding? Probably not. But again, because hoarding can be set off by trauma or loss, it's also possible that there can be a tendency to hoard in the midst of sort of all the grief and trauma associated with narcissistic abuse. Again, maybe not at the level of a disorder. Now, it's, again, this is utter speculation on my point and really something that I'm spitballing because I've seen this happen to similar patterns happen with people I've talked with and worked with over the years. Remember, like I said, hoarding disorder has been associated with loss and with grief, in part why it may also disproportionately affect older adults. But like I said, the numerous losses that people who are experiencing narcissistic abuse experience. So it's not just, this isn't just about one loss. This is about many. You find out that it may be a loss of a marriage, a recognition that a family was like this, a recognition a friend is like this, multiple losses. That could culminate that people would then hold on to stuff that is actually not useful and can make their environment sort of crowded. It also could be that people who experience narcissistic abuse, because these relationships are so confusing, that people may feel compelled to hold on to relics of these relationships or relics of a childhood that they were very confused by. And so the death or the loss of the narcissistic person, whether it was a parent, a grandparent, a partner, may exacerbate the tendency to keep this old stuff from that old time of that life, because these are often very unprocessed, confusing relationship situations. Now, in a person who may already have hoarding disorder, as with those who are living with any mental illness who enter into a narcissistic relationship, what we may see is a lot of cruelty from a narcissistic person towards the person who may be holding on to all this stuff, a dismissive contempt, saying this is disgusting, what is wrong with you, very cruel, very unkind, and a sort of a cruelty in the face of this of these issues with hoarding and holding on to things that, again, that might be creating problems in the space that those people share together. Now, when we look at narcissism itself and hoarding, there's really no research I was able to find that links hoarding or hoarding disorder and narcissism. Let's face it, it's you know, I think for some people who are hoarders, it is possible that it's not, like, again, in younger people who are narcissistic, because it doesn't necessarily look good to the world. You may not see it as much because it may block out the likelihood of them getting narcissistic supply. However, it's possible that in later life, whether because people who are narcissistic as they get older are often at risk for becoming socially isolated because they've burned so many bridges, may have very few social links, and may always be living in this chronically victimized state, it's possible that in the midst of that, they would sort of, in this rather kind of cruel, curmudgeonly way, hold on to old stuff and not be willing to give it up. And keep in mind, people who are narcissistic are very oppositional. They don't like being what they don't like doing what they're told. So if they're told to get rid of something, they may actually, from more of an oppositional place, say, no, I'm not going to do that, versus it being sort of a real decision-making deficit per se. So it wouldn't really fall into that usual kind of definition of hoarding. Like I said, narcissistic people, normatively, not all, but normatively, we see that they're very particular about their things, their spaces. And so it also is possible that they're, you know, people who have hoarding disorder actually get very angry when people move their things around. So like if they move something to a better place or just move anything, people with hoarding disorder will get angry. Well, narcissistic people are very particular. So if you moved any of their stuff, they too would probably get angry, but again, from a different place, from more of an oppositional place, rather than a person with hoarding disorder that's seeming to have these emotional decision-making deficits. Now, when it comes to treatment of hoarding disorder, there's a burgeoning literature suggesting the usefulness of cognitive behavioral therapy as a tool for helping people manage hoarding and helping them sort of understand the linkages between things like loss and really forcing them to sort of think differently about why they're keeping these things. And so, and also in all cases in hoarding disorder, there has to be sort of a systematic addressing of the space, like actually getting the space tidied up. So it can't just be though someone comes in and cleans and leaves because it'll just get filled up again, but it has to be something that's sort of a joint effort between the two people. And between the treatment person and a treatment team and the person with hoarding disorder. And for those of you who want more information on hoarding disorder, please go to our video notes and there will be more information there. So while the links here between both narcissism and narcissistic abuse are a little tenuous, there may be some places where it may not be hoarding disorder, which really is an emotional decision-making disorder, but some patterns associated with holding on to things, being told, I will not give up my stuff, or people who are struggling with the trauma of these relationships who may be sort of holding on to more things than they need, which could also help keep them sort of psychologically stuck in these relationships. I hope that was helpful, and thanks again.